Laurel Hart, and today I'd like to invite you to follow along with me as I demonstrate painting a figure in backlight, and I'm going to be concentrating on keeping my washes clean and fresh and full of color. So I have my figure drawn on my paper, and I have it taped onto my board, and the subject that I'm painting from is a beautiful model who's actually my niece. And I'm going to try to preserve those beautiful lights. A good subject for me is one that has a strong light source, with the sun or the light source coming from an angle onto the subject rather than head on or right above. So that will give me a good balance of light shapes against dark shapes. And preferably for me, I like to have more shadow and less light in the pattern so that I have a nice balance, not an equal balance, but the darks will set off the small light shapes, and it will really draw the eye into that figure. The reason that you see these two source photographs is that this one has gone through some processes in Photoshop to where I have simplified it and taken much of the detail out. That way I can work a little bit better and avoid getting trapped into too much detail right away as I'm painting. You can see that I've also warmed up the flesh tones on the one that I've worked on in Photoshop. This is what I call a separation drawing. It simply is a separation of what is in light, what the sun is striking, versus what is not in light. And if you can force yourself to visualize mentally this way, you can paint much easier the essence of a beautiful figure, eliminating all of the unnecessary detail and creating this beautiful balance of light against the shadow parts. If you can see in an abstract way like this, it will actually give you a more realistic figure in your painting. This is a grayscale and value finder that I rely on a lot in my painting, and you get it through the Color Wheel Company. I like this one specifically because it's divided into your lights and darks. You got the lights on one side and the darks on the other, and I've numbered them 1 through 10. The lights on the right and the darks there on the left. Then I've also marked the wash one side and the wash two on the other side. The reason that this is important is that I've come up with a method that I call the watercolor laundry method. Getting a good clean wash in watercolor is not unlike getting a good clean wash in laundry. When we do laundry, we separate our wash into two batches, lights and darks. I use that same method in watercolor in my washes, darks and lights. When we separate our laundry, we don't want the dark clothes to bleed onto the light clothes, and that's why it's important to keep the lights separate from the darks in watercolor as well, to keep a good clean wash. When I put this first wash in, it will only be values 1 through 5. I can use any colors, but I just don't want to go any darker than a 5. That value is going to go over everything in this subject that is not in direct sunlight. So this first wash is going to cover all of the image that is not in direct sunlight, leaving the whites of the paper as the lights. It's very important that I let that first wash completely dry before I come in with the second wash of the darker values. If I come in over the first wash while it's wet with these dark values, it's going to muddy up the wash. Two more things that are going to help in keeping a clean wash are, first of all, painting on a slant. If you saw my board at the beginning of the video, I'm painting on an angle of about a 45 degree. That's going to help gravity draw the paint down the page
and blend these colors as I'm painting, and they'll flow down from the top to the bottom. The second key thing is that you want to do more mixing of color on the paper than you do on the palette. That will help keep the colors clean on the paper, whereas if I mix them too much on the palette, I'm going to get a gray, and I don't want that. I want a nice, clean wash on the paper. My palette is set up so that I go from my warms to my cools. The main pigments that I use are alizarin crimson permanent, cadmium red light, or sometimes cadmium red medium, cadmium orange. Then skipping over to my yellows, I have a warm and a cool. I have a warm and a cool of all my primaries. I have a cool red and a warm red. And then my lemon yellow is my cool yellow. And next to that, I have cadmium yellow. Then yellow ochre, raw sienna. And then one of my very favorite staple colors is transparent oxide red. You can't find that very easily, but I think Daler Rowney makes a brand of it. And then these are my two blues. The first one is my warm blue, and that is manganese blue. It's hard to find, but it's a very beautiful color that I love. My other blue, my cooler blue, is ultramarine. The other colors on my palette are incidental colors, which I could do without, but I like to have them on my palette. My other essential things are my water bucket, my sponge, a spray bottle to keep my paint wet, a roll of paper towels for blotting and picking up paint where I need to. So beginning now with my initial wash, I'm going to be using a triad of a red, a yellow, and a blue. And the red that I'm going to be using is my alizarin crimson permanent. And I'm going to get a nice, watery, juicy puddle of that on the palette here. In this initial wash, we want a lot of water to less color, or less pigment, I should say. The yellow that I'm using is going to be yellow ochre, and I'm letting those puddles touch each other on the palette, but not necessarily mixing them together with my brush. The blue that I'm going to be using in this wash is my manganese blue, and you can see that as I put these colors onto the palette, they are very high key in color. That is, they're very bright and pure pigments. And again, I'm letting that puddle of the blue touch into the yellow, but I'm not stirring them together, the three colors, or I'm going to get into mud. So let's start putting this wash onto the paper. I'm going to come in onto dry paper, but these washes are going to be very wet, and I want them to mingle as individual pigments on the paper. But as I mentioned earlier, this gravity is going to pull those colors down and help them blend together on their own, so that we're going to get a nice, clean, colorful wash. And the idea here, again, as I talked about earlier, is I want to quickly cover the page. Everything on this subject that is not indirect sunlight is going to be covered with this initial wash. And again, these colors are going to stay on the value scale below a value 5, but they're still going to be very bright in color. You can see that as these colors blend and mix on the paper, I'm getting a whole array of different pigments or different colors. Even though I'm only using those three colors, with the gravity and the slant helping me, I'm creating orange, green, purple. All of these different colors are coming out of this one triad. And I'm just using colors pretty much arbitrarily, except here, as I'm coming into the flesh tones, I'm going to stick with more of, I'm adding in a little bit of the cadmium red, because I know these flesh tones I'm going to want to keep warm and staying into the range of flesh tones. Over here, I'm adding more or less a lot of the bright yellow because I can see in my reference photo that there are going to be pops of bright foliage behind the model there. And I'll let some of those show through at the end of the painting in this wash. Now I'm continuing to come down on the model, putting in more of her skin color there. And notice that I'm just letting the edges of that model merge and blend into the background so that she is almost treated as if she's invisible. The color is just going on over everything that is not in the sunlight. And look already how the light is popping out on the figure. Okay, you might be thinking that these colors are maybe a little bit too raw or a little too brilliant right at this point, but later on, when I come in over this with a second wash, it will tone these colors down, and I will not be, I'll just be letting some of that really beautiful bright color show through, and it won't look so much like maybe a Walt Disney background. One of the things that it might be important to point out here is you can see that on this wash with the gravity pulling it down, there's a bead of color or a bead of water that collects at the bottom of each of those washes. And sometimes this process is referred to as painting with the bead. In other words, I come back in and I pick up that wet bead of water and carry it on down as I'm doing right here. And then that continues to keep that wash in one continuous value or color without any hard edges. One of the things that will separate your work from being too amateur is if you can keep this whole abstract pattern going in this initial wash, it will free you up, it will cover the page quickly, and it won't provide all of those breaking points in amateur work where you have the eye stopping with too many hard edges. You can see that this model is just flowing in and out of the background. There's no background or foreground at this point. And I don't want this to look like the figure is cut out and pasted on a background. And this is a good way to avoid that. Now, you might be thinking that that fence there is a white fence and I should be leaving it white. But in reality, that fence is in shadow. So the values there are going to be darker than white, you know, a number one value on the value scale. And when I come back in with my darker values in the second wash, it's going to really pop that fence out and it will look like it is white. Okay, now I'm coming back over here into the flesh tones again. I do want to keep those where I am going to want that local color of a flesh tone. So I am, and I'm blotting out a little bit of the whites. If I miss them, I can take those out with my paper towel. People think watercolor is really unforgiving, but there are good ways to correct mistakes in watercolor, and good old paper towel is one of them. Okay, I'm going to just skip around those light shapes in the rocks, and I know this is going to eventually be grass down here, so I'm coming in with some warm colors. I know eventually when I come back in there, I'm going to want that to read as a green grass. And I'm working back in a little bit of the shadow area on that skirt or ballerina outfit, whatever it is. Again, I'm picking up a very bright, warm color over here where I know that I want that to look like it's in sunshine there. But as you can see in this wash, nothing has gone beyond the first half of the value scale. And I've been careful to make sure that I don't go darker than a value 5. But if I stay within closer to value 3 and 4 in this initial wash, then it will still have some strength and a really nice, bright, clean color in the wash when it dries. Watercolor dries lighter, so you do need to give it a little more punch than you plan on it having, because it will dry about a value lighter. I'll just pick up these little pieces in between the legs there. And we're just about finished here with the first wash. It's getting exciting. And now it's ready to be dried with a hairdryer. Okay, I've finished drying the first wash and I'm happy with it. It turned out nice. The colors are clean and I let them mingle on the page rather than mix them too much on the palette. And I let gravity do a lot of the work in mixing the color. And you can see at this point how the figure is beginning to come forward onto the paper, becoming a more dimensional shape. So I'm ready now to start on my second wash, which will be the dark values and mid values, going from a value 6 through a value 10. And that will continue to make that figure pop and come forward as a dimensional object. Now that I have my first wash completely dry, I can come back on top of it by wetting it and then letting these darker colors flow in, and it won't disrupt what I've put down already underneath in this initial wash. This second step or second stage, I'll be using smaller brushes because I'll be painting more or less the detail parts of the painting and some of these smaller areas between the fence slats and the leaves and so forth. I'm going to take some paper towel now and clean off this side of my palette here so that I can keep this side free for my dark values now and start on this second part of the painting. The pigments that I generally use for the darker triad or the second wash are, first of all, my darker blue, my ultramarine blue, which will be able to go down to a value 9 or 10. Then I use this transparent oxide red as my yellow. And then the red that I'll be using is still the alizarin crimson permanent. These three colors have a lot more depth to them insofar as they can go to a darker value. The mixture with these three pigments can go down to a value 9 and even to a value 10. I can get a really beautiful black using these three pigments mixed together. I will be using still some of the flesh tones though, because I am doing a figure, so I will be dipping back into this initial flesh color as I go. Now I'm going to show you here what the consistency will look like in this second triad. That's my ultramarine blue and now my transparent oxide red. So I'll be using that mixture of the cadmium red as my red, and I'll go back and forth to that alizarin crimson. I want to start on her hair here though, and you can see now that the pigment is much more concentrated. So in this second wash, kind of the rule of thumb is more pigment and less water than what I used on the initial wash. So I'm going to continue here on the hair. I will work in with these darker values, and then I'm going to come in with a little bit of the flesh tone and touch back into this wet dark paint and pull it down onto her face so that I don't have a hard line between the hairline and her face here. In a figure, the parts of the body that are thin, like ears and the nose, will be a lot redder in tone because of how thin that they are in the light. So I'll continue pulling down this tone in her face. I want to keep the face more of just a suggestion. I don't want to draw too much attention by putting in dark features. So generally a good rule of thumb on the features is to put those in maybe two or three values darker than the flesh tone. And it will really jump out if you use a lot darker value for the features on the face. So a good rule of thumb usually is to put the features in with maybe just a 2 to 3 value jump darker. And I think it'll really look more real that way. When the features are too dark, it doesn't look realistic. And I'm just going to continue on pulling that bead down as I go into her chest. And now that skin that's in even darker shadow there, I'm putting more of that transparent oxide red into the flesh tone, and a little bit of the blue also. And then I'll continue with that mixture of the cadmium orange and cadmium red down the remainder of her arm there. And you can see now that the painting slows down much more in this second wash, where I'm trying to put in more of the detail now and separating this figure out from the background. That tone on her face has dried enough to where I can put the eyes in now and still have them bleed just a little bit so that they have a soft effect to them and don't look quite so hard-edged. And again, using my paper towel to blot things, I sometimes find I do better removing paint than I do putting it on. I'll continue down on this arm. Bring that right over into the bouquet that she's holding. Here I am losing the edge of that arm just a little bit, so the figure still does meld into the background. I don't, again, as I mentioned earlier, I don't want her to look like she's cut out and pasted on. I want her to connect into the background in places. I want to strengthen that shadow area under her chin just a little bit. with a bit, a little bit of a darker value. An interesting rule that I might mention here is that I guess it's been kind of scientifically proven that the shadow side of a figure in sunlight is 40% darker than the light area of the flesh. And so if you figure that out on a value scale, the form shadow on your model is going to be 4 degrees darker than the part of the model that is in light. So 4 degrees on a value scale is the same as 40% on a 10-degree value scale. So if my model's flesh tone in sunlight is a 1, then the form shadow on the model will be a value 5. And that's a really good rule to follow. You'll find that that will really make your models look realistic in sunlight. I'm just going to soften some of these edges here so that they just kind of blend into that sunlight area on the top of her head. And add a little bit of a warmer tone there at the top. I'm going to continue working down into the model's skirt here, bringing in a little bit of a darker shadow tone on that area where into the form shadow on her skirt. Again, these mixtures of color down in here on these darker tones are just mixtures of that same triad, alizarin and the ultramarine blue and some of the transparent oxide red, just in differing mixtures of those three colors blended together. And here I'm adding in a little bit of warm color into those gray washes there so that I don't get too monotonous. And I just want a little bit of a pop of color in there. So it's in this second wash again that you can get a little bit fussier and take your time on some of these areas where you want a little more detail. Her legs are more in shadow here, so I want to just get a little darker value on them at this point. And as this figure begins emerging now from that initial first wash, it begins to get really exciting as you see the dimension start to build up in the painting. I'm coming back into the face here just a little bit, but I don't want to overdo it. I want it to be just the suggestion of those features. The likeness that I want to capture of this model is not necessarily a portrait of what her face looks like. I just want to capture that gesture of how she's standing in the sunlight there. Okay, now let's start working into the background here. As you can see, I'm wetting the paper with my water, and I'm just getting it wet so that the next colors that I flow in on here are going to be very liquid and blend into each other. And now we're going to see this model start to really pop out into space here as she comes forward in the picture plane, as I put these darker values in behind her. And I'm going to be leaving, painting around some of these little pieces of light that are in the foliage in the background there. And I'll be blending those in so that they're not going to be isolated out there. But I'm painting around them so I won't forget to leave them there. But when you come in with a dark value behind those little pieces of light, that backlit part on her shoulder there that's in the sunlight, you can see how that pops that forward and brings that out, the darker values against the lights there. And I'm going to bring that dark value right on in into this bouquet in the flowers there, so that that comes in and out of the background there. You can see how much more of a muted or grayer tone I'm using in these pigments as I go in this second wash. So that's, you can see I've still got three colors of my triad that are showing there. You can see the red, you can see the blue, and you can see the yellow. But as they flow onto the paper, they're blending themselves into a whole myriad of other colors as they go. And that's the fun part of watercolor. What I'm doing here on painting the fence is actually negative painting. I'm actually painting what isn't there rather than what is there. I'm painting the space in between those fence slats. And now you can see how white that picket fence looks as I come in with those dark values behind it. Everything is relative. If you put that white fence against a dark value, it's going to look lighter and lighter to the eye. A really good mixture that I like to use when painting green is using the transparent oxide red mixed with ultramarine blue and some sap green mixed in with it, and then adding in some yellow. That'll give you a really nice green mixture. I just don't want the edges of those flowers to look so even. I'm trying to make them look more like they have petals on them than just balls of flower. I'm just adding a little more color into these flowers. More than what's actually in the reference photo, but I think it needs it. Now here again, I'm painting behind with the fence here, putting the darks in between those fence slats. I'm adding some brighter yellow into that foliage behind the fence to vary the values back there a little bit. I'm wetting this grassy area down below the fence now to come in with some darker values in that shadow area under there. I just want this pigment to come in under here, a really deep, dark value to set that fence off and set off the edge of her skirt there. I want to just let the paint flow into that wet area. Okay, I want to go back into the fence there. And because that section of the fence turns there, these spaces between the fence slats are a little bit narrower. I need to add a little dimension onto the post here. Put a shadow side onto that. A bit of another darker value down there. I'm wetting the right side of the paper now, getting ready to put in that foliage and the wall behind her on the right side there. And see how I'm painting around those lighter leaves that are in the light back there. I'll blot a little bit of those out. So when I was talking about leaving that bright yellow to show through that I put down in the initial wash, that's what I was talking about. You can see how that creates the foliage in light there by painting behind those leaves. And I want to set off her face there with a nice dark. I'm just strengthening that yellow a little bit in the background with a little bit of cadmium yellow. The areas of greatest contrast in the painting are going to be the places where the eye goes first. And I think I'm working on that right now here, where you see that dark green against that sliver of light on her shoulder and all the way down the side of the figure where that skirt is in light. That's, I think, where the eye is going to go first. I'm just putting in a little bit of that green foliage that's coming down on the front of the wall so that I can set that off with a darker value behind it. That little sliver of light that's going along the top of the wall is important to keep that in so that you can tell the distinction between the wall and the background foliage there. And again, I'm just painting in behind what's behind that fence to make it jump forward in the space. I want to complete the bottom right corner now of the painting, coming in with some of the warm tones of that grassy area there. I want to go in right on top of that wet wash there with some darks to bring that shadow area in, but leave it wet so that it's going to blend into that color in back there. If I haven't left that wet enough underneath, I'll take a little bit of water on my brush and just with clean water and run it along the edge of those darks so that they bleed a little bit into the background. I want this dark to really set off the edge of the skirt there and push that forward. This part of the fence is a little bit more in shadow, so I'm going to just run a light wash along it to take it down maybe a degree or so in value. I just want to soften up some of the edges on this part in the grass. And by the way that I'm doing that is just bringing in some clear water and running it over the edges of blending it a little bit more together. Now I'm just going to be adding a few touches of final details on this painting. I need to kind of clarify her feet a little bit better and add a few little punches of darks here and there in the folds of her skirt, and we'll be about done.
I've concluded the painting now, and as you can see, I feel good about meeting my goals. I wanted to keep my colors clean and not muddy at all, and I feel like that was accomplished. I wanted to make sure that the figure stood out, that you could really see that she's in that beautiful backlight, and I feel good about that happening as well. I hope that you will tune in again to one of our teaching demonstrations, and we'll catch you next time on our next subject. Thank you.